Watch out.
Spreading the canoe is undoubtedly the most exciting part of the canoe carving process. Things move fairly quickly, and a mistake can cause serious issues. Over 100 visitors drop by to observe the action. Elders, school kids, community, and tribal members.
I'm Ed Carrier, a Suquamish tribal elder. My Suquamish family history comes from Chief Wahalchuk, the last chief of the Suquamish tribe. When I got into the canoe journeys, I wanted to carve my own canoe. And Dwayne was very generous and secured the log, and he came over to my house and taught me how to carve my own canoe.
Other visitors came to help and observe the day-long process. Members of the Chinook tribe on the Lower Columbia River came to help and learn and offer a blessing at the end of the successful day. The canoe was placed in the center of a cleared area and blocked at both ends to be upright and level. About 10 inches of water was added inside the canoe, and fires were built on both sides. Spreading takes place both by raising the water temperature to create steam and drying the outside so that the sides spread outward.
So traditionally when they did this, they would heat rocks in the fire. They'd take them out with tongs, usually U-wood tongs. And I've tried it that way. It's really tough. You gotta get really close to, in order to get the tongs to pick up a heavy rock. It's not fun. It burns your face and makes you make funny expressions. I started using these engine heads. It was not my idea, it was Ed Carrier's idea. And on his last canoe, we used that instead of the rocks. And the rocks have a tendency to sometimes shatter, and the engine blocks don't. They hold the heat longer than a rock does. And these little baskets, I came up with that idea using chicken wire and 3/8 rebar. And that way, you can pick up the basket with a hook on each end, guy on each end with the hook. And when you think the engine head's hot enough, just pick it off and set it in the canoe and put another basket with an engine head in it on top of the fire and just keep relaying like that. Leave it in the water for half an hour or so and pull it out, heat it again, then put another different set of engine heads in the canoe. And in that way, you gradually get the water hot enough. We'll probably get it up to about 196 degrees.
The canoe gradually spreads outward, and the center bottom, or reverse rocker, moves downward, while the bow and stern move upwards.
On the drawing, I've shown the pre-spreading configuration of the canoe in red lines. This is the profile. Red line before spreading. The bottom of the canoe with the reverse rocker in red line, top view showing the gunwale line before spreading, and here's an end view with cross sections at stations, and I've got like five stations shown here. Each one of them is pre-spreading, and over here is what it looks like after spreading. This drops down and out to become this.
During the spreading process, a significant crack developed on the starboard side. Steaming was temporarily halted, and the canoe was drained while temporary plywood cleats were installed with screws to prevent further spreading. Later, these would be replaced with circular butterfly patches. The beam width was constantly checked to measure progress, and temporary thwarts were tapped into place in an attempt to assist the spreading.
We had to help it along a little bit by tapping these sticks in. And I don't like to do that because it puts strain on the canoe. Every log is different. It's been said by some of the older people that every canoe has a mind of its own, and that's probably true to some degree. Yeah, but I didn't expect it to do it there. I expected to do it down along the chines. Yeah, I think it's because I had it restricted for too long. Well, I had a 2x4 across screwed into the top of the gun so it couldn't move. And I probably should have taken it loose. In the process of spreading, the canoe might have cracked a little bit. This is what happened right here. This is very thin. It's 3/4 of an inch. Actually, it got a little bit thinner than that, unbeknownst to us. It's like 5/8 of an inch. It's quite thin. And it runs right into a big solid area that is very thick. So when you get a combination of a big, thick area right next to a thin area with the grain running like this, that's a potential weak spot. There's too much tension concentrated in one little spot like that. And as a result, this opened up. The gunwale came open. It was actually opened about that much. We managed to catch it in time and squeeze it back together and put temporary cleats like this just to hold it for a while. Well, later on we put these butterflies, modern day looking butterflies, made from 3/8 plywood, exterior plywood, and then they're glued into the crack. And that holds that pretty good. It'll never come apart there.
Using the guideline of 7 beams of length for a traditional canoe, it was determined that the ideal beam width would go from the existing 31 to 32 inches at the gunwale to 42 or more inches, a 10 plus inch desired spread.
Okay, we started out with 31 inches across here, and now we have 46. So we came out 15 inches.